Good evening, everyone. This will be Be'ezrat Hashem, a live broadcast on Facebook and will be on my website tomorrow, God willing. We just finished a beautiful broadcast in Hebrew to many pages in Israel, and we're going to do the same thing now in English. And this lecture will be Le'ilui Nishmat Menashe Ben Nekadam, just passed from the corona. This lecture is sponsored for his neshama. Also, Refuat Blanca Margalit, Bat Miriam Margalit, and Leilui Nishmat Tuvia Ben Arav Avraham Menachem, and all the people who passed in the communities here, a lot of the tzaddikim. Also, Refuat HaNefesh, Refuat HaGuf of Reuven Ben Yael, Yonina, Simcha, Chana, Bat Shifra, Samara, Aviva Bat Shifra, Uva Chaya Bat Samara, Aviva Shifra Bat Sivya, Yaakov Reuven Ben Haika. That's the name I remember. Those who I forgot, please forgive me. As we know, the situation with the corona is still going on. It's an ongoing tragedy. Every day we're finding out that more and more people passing, and more people that we knew, and more funerals, unfortunately, is a very big tragedy. A story that really broke my heart today is when I read, someone sent me that a woman in Israel passed away, and she has a disabled child, mentally challenged, and the daughter did not understand that her mother passed. She was laying down on the floor. And she was trying to feed her and talk to her and move her. She didn't understand why she's not waking up. And this was going on for a few days. I don't know exactly, 3 or 4 days. She was laying like this until finally they broke into the apartment and found that horrible, heartbreaking situation. So, unfortunately, this is it. And another Talmid Chacham in London left a note for his son, told him that you should know that I did not die from the virus, I died from starvation. That 3 days prior to this writing of this letter, the nurses there in London on purpose starved him to death. I also heard a story like this here in New York, that the antisemite nurses that works in a hospital, they don't fulfill their obligation. You know, when you become a doctor or a nurse, you have to sign that you will help every person who needs medical help. But in reality, that's not the case. They have some people they prefer to give attention, and some people, as usual, for thousands of years, that they just hate just because they're Jewish. And instead of helping them to get better, they're helping them to die. I told the person that spoke to me about his father-in-law today that even something like that, as horrible as it sounds, and we really hope that there's not that many cases like this, but even something like that, as horrible as it sounds, even something like this was based on the approval of Hashem. Meaning that if a person is getting the virus or not, it's 100% Hashem's decision. If Hashem decided that a person will get it, he also knows in advance which ambulance will come and pick him up and what hospital is going to take him and who are the staff over there and which doctors are good and bad and which nurses are antisemites, murderers, and which one are good nurses. Everything is calculated precisely. So if it happens that a Jew fell into the hand of these murderers, even something like this was decided on Rosh Hashanah. As hard as it is to digest what I'm saying, that's one of the principles of Emunah, of faith. And if we don't believe what I just said, based on what the Torah said, not me, if we don't believe it, we're basically infidels. You know, it's hard, I know. It's hard for a person sometimes to understand, especially when it's a relative of him and the emotions are playing a big role here. And the same thing, he cannot speak to Holocaust survivors about some Musar, certain subject, because when you begin to speak about it, the heart take over the brain, and the brain cannot obviously function because the emotions explode, and a person basically reacts with his emotions when the heart wins the arguments against the brain. This is a very common phenomena. It happens to all of us, some more, some less. The more Talmid Chacham you are, knowledgeable in Torah and learning many years and knows the principles and the ideology of Hashem and how He runs the world and all the Gemarot that discuss life and death and sicknesses and supervision and all these and reward and punishment and the decisions that are made on Rosh Hashanah, the Judgment Day, the beginning of the new Jewish year. Once you know the whole picture, you have a clear puzzle. And then everything makes sense. This is what the Torah says, Mishpatei Hashem Emet Tzadeku Yachdav. The truth of God, the divine truth, you can see the truth in it when it's all combined into one big picture. If you have a little bit from here, a little bit from there, it sometimes looks not connected. And you don't understand really what's going on. But if you know, the more you know, the clearer the picture is. And even something like this, if it happened, that means Hashem decided on that on Rosh Hashanah. If that person did not deserve to get something like this, Hashem will direct the hospital to the ambulance to a different hospital, or even the same hospital, but within a different shift, a different nurse, a better nurse. You know, even who's going to get a respiratory, if they have it, they don't have it. Everything is supervised 100% by the Creator of the world, and thank God for it. That is nothing is random. Imagine if things would be left to be random, it would drive us crazy. At least now the comfort that we have is that we know that nothing happened for no reason. Everything Hashem does is for the sake of the individual. Even when He takes His life away. Some people, the best thing that happened to them is that they finished their life here. They were suffering here, they're sick here. They had poverty, they had a lot of other problems here, they died and they go to heaven. Definitely don't miss this world. Some people will come back here right away in reincarnation. A brand new baby will be born in the next few weeks and will have a much better life, or born to a better family, better environment. That could also be the case. We cry many times for tragedies because we don't see the entire picture. If we were able to see everything, all the reincarnations of the souls in different bodies, and what's the reason for this and that, and what the person did and did not do, and why Hashem decided to do it in this way and not the other way, everything we would be able to know. Obviously we can, because we're not God. The Rambam writes, Maimonides wrote, if I knew everything he knows, I would be him. The only way to know what God does is to be Him. And there's only one God. Therefore, nobody can understand His actions and all the connections and all the chain of reactions and consequences. And this is just a short introduction to all these people who are in grief now and suffering. It's a lot deeper than what you see. It's sometimes, if you would be able to know more details, you would not kill yourself too much. You would know that some of these things really help the soul, especially the suffering. Also, before I forget, that this lecture will be also for Refuah Shlema of my good friend, Chai Chaim Feles. You know, his English name is Kenny, a great person. He also has corona and heart condition, hard for him to breathe. So Bezrat Hashem, this lecture and the one I made before in Hebrew also will be for his Refuah Shlema, Bezrat Hashem. So we move on. We know that everything that happens in the world, we have to see with a magnified glass what's the message. If we miss that, there's no guarantee that we'll understand why God do what He does. But we have rules. We have principles. The principles are as follow. Everything that happens in the world is measure for measure. Guarantee. Has to be measure for measure. Give one example. The mayor of New York and the education board of directors, they decided to force the Jewish yeshivot to learn secular studies that are not interested in. They want to teach them about gays and about gay needs and about gays' lifestyle. They force them to watch all kinds of dirty things that those people who love to do abomination acts, to force it into the yeshivot in England and in here. You know, in Israel, they've been trying for decades. But here, in the last year, this is was the, that's what the talk. You're not going to teach it, we'll cut your budget. We'll put you out of business. We'll close your yeshivot. Basically, forcing them, that's what you have to teach. Hashem say, yes, that's what you want. You want to destroy the only few pure souls that are left in this world. You want to contaminate them. You want to teach them your abomination and your dirt. That's what's going to happen. None of you will go to school. All the schools in England, here, and many other countries who wanted to push this agenda are all shut down. Why yeshivas are shutting down? Yeshiva also shut down. How do you explain that? Very simple. I can give you a long list of problems that yeshivas has as well. Nobody says yeshivas are perfect. You understand? There are kids who are thrown out of school for minor issues. How could they take the risk of destroying that soul, throwing them out because they make a lot of noise or because they don't behave 100%? They're not robots. Maybe they ask some annoying questions. Maybe they have challenge in faith. Maybe they're not so sure. Maybe they are more clever than the average kids, that they ask questions that sounds like heresy, but it really comes from a real desire to learn and to understand that they are not wasting their life following a book of religion that could have been a man-made religion, like 80,000 religions and cults that were all fake and came after Judaism. We know, as if you watch my film Torah and Science or The Purpose of Life, that I bring many, many proofs over there that leaves no doubt that our Torah is the only authentic divine religion. It was given to the Jewish people in front of millions of people in a public event. The Torah knew all the future prophecies, knowledge about nature that leaves no doubt. It's the book of the creator of the world. However, little kids not always know it. They may ask questions that sounds like chutzpah, sounds like heresy. Many of these kids paid a very serious price that they threw them out of this yeshivot just because they didn't want to handle their questions, annoying questions. That's enough reason to close many yeshivot out there, and I'm not saying names, we're not talking about anybody. I don't even know names, to be honest with you. I don't know what's happening for good and for bad in any of the yeshivot. I hope and pray to God that most of them are kosher and good. That's what I hope and I want to believe. But I speak from what I hear from all the people who come to me and cry about the problems of what happened. I've seen in my own eyes cases like this. So the yeshivot are not clean. They spilled a lot of blood of a lot of the souls over the years, and maybe Hashem got fed up with that. Second is the cost of all of that. The average school charging more than $15,000 to $20,000 a kid, and it's not realistic. Families are collapsing. They just cannot handle such expense. If they have 7, 8, 9 children, they're going to need $500,000 just to survive. It's not realistic. So maybe Hashem is fed up with that. It could be that's another reason. Could be the teachers that teach in some of these places are not exactly righteous as they should have been. Maybe they themselves have all kinds of university influence and all kinds of rotten ideology and lack of faith and all kinds of other problems, which Hashem said better the kids will be ignorant and home than become infidel learning from such a person. That could be another reason. It could be abuse, mental abuse, physical abuse. We heard about cases like this over the years. That could be another reason. It could be that maybe people did not appreciate the yeshivot. Maybe it could be the other way around. Maybe they do a fantastic job, some of them, and the people or parents take it for granted, don't appreciate it. And Hashem say, you know what? Handle your kids on your own. Let's see how you can educate them. You keep complaining and complaining about the rabbis and the yeshivot, that how much money they make already to raise your children and teach them the entire Gemara and Mishnah. Maybe let's see how you're doing it for 2-3 months on your own. That could also be a reason. So basically, there could be many, many reasons. Now, we don't know. None of us know. There's no prophets in this generation. In past generation, we were lucky enough to come to a prophet, and he will tell us what Hashem say and what's the message. Today we don't have it. The Gemara says after the destruction of the second temple, there's no more prophecies. Not by the Jews, not by the Gentiles. Back in time, even Gentiles had few prophets, as we know. Today, nobody is a prophet. Some rabbis may have Ruach HaKodesh, great intuition, divine intuition here and there, but that's not sufficient enough to reach a level of a prophecy to speak to the generation in the name of God. And definitely, I'm not intending to do so. I know exactly my limitation, but I just follow the guidelines and the regulations and the rules of the Torah. Rule number one, everything that happens in the punishment, you find hints to what was done wrong prior to that. Now you're dealing with the consequences. Check why. Why the schools are shut? Why the synagogues are shut? Why? Maybe people spoke over there. Maybe there are too many clowns there. Maybe there's too much speaking in the middle of learning the Torah, reading the Torah. Maybe people come late, disrespect the tefillah. Maybe the people that pray are not Shomer Shabbat even, and make all kinds of horrible sins that Hashem say, you know what, with this kind of Shliach Tzibur, better there's not going to be synagogue. Maybe the people in the board are big, wicked people that will not let kosher speaker come and speak and rebuke the public. They will prevent any attempt to save the souls of the community. They just want politics. They want to make everything sugar-coated. Everybody lives in a dream that they're all going to heaven. Maybe Hashem say, you know what, if this synagogue will not let kosher speaker come and speak the truth of my Torah, they won't be open at all. There could be another reason. It could be politics, hatred between people, racism. It could be maybe horrible behaving towards converts that can happen in some places. Maybe they disrespected them, maybe they kicked them out. I don't know what the case can be. I'm just bringing possibilities. We're not making any decisions here. I'm just bringing all kinds of possibilities. But through what Hashem did, we definitely know one thing. That Hashem told us in our face, I'm not interested, not in your prayers in Minyan, not in your synagogue services, not in your learning Torah in Chevruto, together in yeshivot or in groups. Basically, I'm not interested in anything you're doing in public. I want each one of you to be isolated, even old people with no mercy. People in their 80s, in their 70s, 90s, that need their grandchildren like oxygen to come, to bring, to clean, to have company for them. They're all isolated. Maybe it's the way of Hashem say, none of you cherished your parents or your grandparents, took them for granted, you thought they were annoying, you made comments, you made fun of them. I've seen it throughout the years. No one can say it doesn't exist. So maybe you're better off not even have the merit to stand in the same room like them. That could be also another reason. Total isolation. Holidays, everyone is alone. Leila Seder, no guests. No minyanim. Nobody reads the Torah. Nobody hears the story of Pesach in the Kriyat HaTorah. Halel, you do alone with one or two kids of yours. Obviously, it's not the way it should be. All this, what Hashem did to us, add on top of it the financial disaster. Hundreds of hundreds of hundreds of billions of dollars got wiped out. Jewish property, Jewish accounts, Jewish homes, Jewish companies. The rest of the world suffering in trillions. Who knows how many trillions? How many years it's going to take to recover, nobody knows. Nobody even knows when this virus will be over. I just heard a rumor that in China it spreads again now. I don't know if it's true or not. Nobody really knows. Nobody even knows if you got it, if you can get it again. Even to this question, you don't have a clear answer. Yeah, they say if you got it, most likely you won't get it. But nobody really knows. Nobody even knows how long it can stay in the system. Maybe 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks, who knows? It's such a thing that Hashem made that brought all of us to go down on our knees, to put our ego down, to throw away our nonsense, such as sport, theaters, Hollywood, all this shopping and vacations and all the materialistic things that we are so addicted to throw everything to the garbage and basically beg for our life. back to pay the rent, back to pay the mortgage, back to put food on the table. Today they show a video of a guy in Israel that has a little restaurant, falafel restaurant in Israel. You could not see that and not cry. You saw how the man is crying. He doesn't know what to do. All the checks he gave suppliers, the bank returned all of them. He's already more than a month close. He cannot bring food. He opened up his wallet. He said, look, I don't have money left. Nothing. I don't know what to do. I can't sell. I can't open the store. How long this is going to go? Unfortunately, there are more than a million people in this situation in Israel alone, which is close to 20% of the Jewish population there. By the Arabs, there's nothing better. They also live in the same place. The difference between the Jews and the Arabs is that when the Jews will suffer and won't have what to do, they sit home and cry and scream or write in the internet comments. The Arabs already say today, if you're not going to give us what we want and this and medicine to Gaza and this, we'll blow up the area. Out of desperation, they will go into violence. What do you expect from the Hamas? What did you ever get from them? Something good. Only murder and more violence and bloodshed. So that can make our situation even worse. So we don't really know. We don't know. I think personally, if you want to ask my opinion, that the harder the weather will be in Israel and in New York and in Europe, the less cases will be. And slowly, slowly, less and less people will die. And slowly, slowly, they will reopen the businesses. And things will start to go back to be a little bit like it used to be. There will be still very difficult time financially. Remember, millions of people unemployed. When people are unemployed, they don't pay rent, they don't pay mortgages, they don't pay debt. It creates, it's a snowball. It affects a lot of other people. There will be a lot of people that are fired, and who knows what can it lead. It can lead to a lot of crime. It could lead to a very hard days coming. And when you are Jewish, you are usually the one who is exposed to the highest amount of danger, just because the average Gentiles, many of them are anti-Semites. They have Nazi ideology. And they're always going to find who to blame, and it's usually the Jews. So that's why we have to be ready for these days, not to live in illusion or anything like this. For the people who keep asking if now it's the time to move to Israel, what changed now? It's terrible here, and it's terrible in Israel. There is anti-Semitism against Jews here. There's anti-Semitism against Jews in Israel, especially if you're religious. If you're religious, every day you will be attacked by people, by the media nonstop, and also by the police. It's unbelievable. I can show you dozens of videos. When the police come to where religious people try to pray outside of the synagogue in a parking lot in Minyan and far away from each other, they come, they blow up the davening and ruins it and arrest people. And they go to the Arabs, they're very, very close, like no virus. Mamash, hundreds of them, attached in one place, singing, doing, marching. They beg them, excuse me, maybe you can move. This is it. Israeli police going to hurt religious people because they hate religion. They hate the Torah. They hate everything that smells like Judaism. Unfortunately, that's the sad truth. They're going to go to these Arabs over there. You have to see. You can see on the video. Mamash, a whole different approach. This is an example of what's going on here. So today alone, they found swastika in a synagogue because the Prime Minister of Israel allowed already to do minyanim outside of the synagogue today for the first time after a month. And already they found swastika. I believe it was in Ashdod, if I'm not mistaken, in Israel. People that they brought to Israel. I said that they brought a lot of Amalekim, Nazis, they brought from the countries around Russia into Israel. They have tattoos, swastikas, websites, Christian synagogues. They're all Aryans. They admire Hitler. The Israeli stupid government brought them into Israel, close to a million. Not all of them, of course, are Nazis, but many of them are not hiding it. They live now among us. Not only we had the Hamas and Hezbollah and Palestinians and all the rest of the problems. Not only we have 120,000 Muslims came from Sudan and Eritrea and filled up Israel and occupied half of Tel Aviv. That the police are afraid to go there. On top of all of that, you still have Nazis that came from the Russian countries around Russia in the last 25 years and filled up Israel with anti-Semite Aryans. This is right away. So if you think the situation there is better than here, politically, it's not better. However, there will be a time everybody will be forced to move to Israel. When is that time? We don't know. Only Hashem knows. One of the prophecies is that when the Mashiach would come, the Messiah, he will gather all the Jews into Israel. He will gather everyone. So there will be a period of time that we will all be forced to leave everything here and run away. That's why I started to say a year ago in my lectures to people that can afford to buy a house in Israel, buy it. Probably now maybe the prices are even lower with all the crisis that is coming now. People will be more desperate to sell. For those who are trying to sell their homes, maybe you can get 20% off the price. If you can afford to buy for you, for your children, something to be there, because one way or the other, we're going to have to run to Israel one day. Now, you may ask me, but based on what you just said of going on in Israel and the hatred to the religion and the antisemitism in Israel, how do you want us to run to Israel? Make no mistake. When the time will come that we all have to run to Israel, not of this antisemite will have a minute that they will survive. When it's going to happen, Hashem is already going to take care of all these wicked people, all the Erev Rav, as I spoke hundreds of times over the years with the lecture and brought proofs from the prophets and from the Gemara, what is going to happen. But for the time being, every decision that a person has to make, if to move to anywhere, include Israel, he has to consult with his own personal rabbi that knows him. Knows who he is, knows his job, his family status, income, the relationship between him and his wife and children, where what schools the children are learning, he has chevruta, he has good community, they're happy, they're close to Hashem here, the children are in good environment of Torah, of what's the question, who's going to jeopardize all this, to go on an adventure that may end in a tragedy, spiritual tragedy. But if a person has nothing here, like I said many times in the past, if you're poor here and you know your children don't have good schools and everything here is horrible, you might as well live in the Holy Land. So even if it will be bad over there, at least you live in a holy place. Now pay attention. No matter what happened in the world, it's always different in Israel. In Israel, the most infected areas with the coronavirus are Bnei Brak and Jerusalem. Why? It's all ultra-Orthodox people. Same way in Borough Park, in Crown Heights, and Williamsburg, and Lakewood, and Monroe, and Muncie. All the most religious Jewish neighborhoods in America suffer the most of America by percentage. Many cases of the virus, and many dead people. Close to 700 names I saw myself already. 700 deaths. In our communities here in New York alone, and New Jersey. So therefore, the religious communities in the world, in London, in England, Manchester, the same thing. But when it comes to Israel, thousands of people in Bnei Brak got infected, and in Jerusalem, but hardly any cases of death. And even those who died are very old people that most likely would die anyway, with or without the corona. So you see, even when there is judgment in the world, even when Hashem is shaking the whole world and poverty and isolation and everything that we go through here and in Israel is a different approach. This is what the Torah says, Eretz asher enei Hashem elokecha ba mireshit ha-shana v'ad acharit ha-shana. The land that the eyes of your God is in it, meaning he loves it, he cherishes it, he adores the place, he adores the land. It's different air, different everything, different way of judging things, different way of giving things. Eretz asher enei Hashem Elokecha ba, the eyes of your God is in that land from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. Obviously, the eyes of God is in every place in the world, otherwise the world could not run a minute without the supervision of Hashem. But the Torah emphasized the love and the special caring that Hashem has to the Holy Land, which you don't have in any other place in the world, no matter what religious community in the world, it does not come to the level or the league of the people of Israel, and the Torah of Eretz Israel is in a higher level. The children of Eretz Israel are much smarter than the children of the rest of the world. They have this Israeli chutzpah, which sometimes, unfortunately, is not so good. But most of the time, when it comes to learning, it's very sharp, bright brains. You see, the avira of Eretz Israel machkima. The Gemara says, just the air that you breathe in Eretz Israel make you smarter. By the way, it also applies to the goyim. If you check the Arabs all over the Middle East, all over the world, where do you find the most clever Arabs, the Palestinians, in Israel? The land of Israel, the air that they breathe, make them also sharper. You see how they go on CNN, they crush the Israeli speakers sometimes in debates with lots of lies, but even to know how to lie, you need a brain. Understand? In the end, everyone will get what they deserve, obviously. No one would ever reach his goal with lies. The lie will collapse eventually. But you see the sneaky way, the conniving way, all these lies and manipulation and modifying the truth and forging and faking. You don't find it in other countries. Everything there. Why? The air that you breathe in Israel, it's a different level of air from the rest of the world. This is what the Torah said. This is what Hashem said. Avira d'Eretz Israel machkima. So what is the real message here? Really the tragedy here. That we can't even pray in Minyan. We can't open the synagogue. We can't go into the yeshiva. We can't sit and learn Torah like we used to. We can't say Kaddish. People are isolated. People are mentally destroyed. So many suicide cases. How many cases of divorce are coming as soon as they open the quarantine? I don't know how the Bedin, the Jewish court, will handle so many cases of divorce cases. You know, I've got so many comments from all kinds of people that people copy and send of people waiting already for the Bedin to open because they can't wait another day just to go and file for divorce. Why is it? The communication was never great. It was never spiritual. It was all based on material, based on body only. Now you're stuck with someone you can't stand for 6 weeks. I don't have to tell you the results of it. And that's what's going on right now. Enough is enough. That's what they say. Why? As long as they were away from each other, working, traveling, this. Okay, they have to deal with each other very little. Now when it became intense, this is the consequences of it. So the economy is collapsing. The consequences of economy that collapses, poverty and crime and drug and abuse and depression and suicide cases. Plus, you know, if a country has to feed tens of millions of people that don't have a job, the country itself can go bankrupt. There's just as much as the country can print money because the value of the currency will go to zero. Then you won't be able to buy anything with your money. You try to go out of the country and try to buy something, you get a $100 bill, you won't be able to buy a box of gum. Why? Because the more money you print and give to people, the more you jeopardize the future of the country. And that's not a lesson in economy. Everyone who knows a little bit economy knows what I'm talking here. Now, there's one major question that's really the subject of this lecture now. From all the Orthodox people that died, we cannot miss that many of the names have a title in front of them. Rabbi X, Rabbi Y, Rabbi, 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 many, many rabbis. It's true that today almost every religious person thinks he's a rabbi. It's true. It's also true that everyone who has opened himself a synagogue, automatically they nominate him to be a rabbi. That's also true. It's true that people that have all kinds of degrees from universities, they also make them rabbi. By the reform people, you don't even have to be Jewish to be a rabbi. The word rabbi is not always represent what it really means. So just because ever they say rabbi, 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 it doesn't really mean everyone was a rabbi. But we cannot deny that some of the names that pass are not only rabbis, are important rabbis. Some of them from Muncie, very famous Talmidei Chachamim. In England, few Talmidei Chachamim, even in Israel, Lakewood, Monroe, Rebbe's, Admorim, Rashi Yeshivot, all kinds of Askanim of Torah. And we have to ask ourselves, where is the logic here? Remember, we must investigate what happens, what is Hashem's message. If you don't do it, you go against the rule. The Rambam says when there is a tragedy, you have to blow the trumpets. You have like police, they go on the street and blow the trumpets. Why do you have to blow the trumpets? For everyone at home to know it's a time of tragedy. Whether it's a pandemic or war, or all kinds of problems. What happened when you blow up the trumpets? People will begin to do tshuva, to repent, to pray, to cry, to read more tehillim, to give more charity. Now it's the time more than ever to give charity. For two reasons. Why? If you let the institution collapse, you may not be able to bring them back. You're going to have to live without them for good. And that's going to be a massive long-term damage. Because it's the same thing a person in a respirator. If you don't connect them to the respirator, by tomorrow or the next day, he'll be dead. All you have to survive is a few days on a respirator, you may save his life and he will live with you another 30 years. It's very similar to what happened to many of the yeshivot, organization. So that's what I spoke about in the last lecture. If people won't care now, they will pay a much bigger price later on. That's one thing. Second thing is, what is the number one tool to get saved from a death decree? If God forbid on Rosh Hashanah, God signed our name as in a dead list. There's only one thing that can actually save our life. What is it? Tzedakah, charity. Now, some people may say, okay, charity, but I just got laid off. I'm unemployed. My business is closed. My restaurant is closed. I don't have money. I have payments coming. I don't know what's going to be in the future, even if I have a little saving and may die after a few months. That's the challenge. That's the test if you are a believer in Hashem or you believe in your saving. If you believe in your real estate. If you believe in your talent, if you believe in your job, the Torah says, I am the God who feed every creature, animals, people, Jews, non-Jews. It's all me, not your college degree, not your education. King Solomon already wrote it. It's a fact. Lo lachachamim lechem. Wisdom does not bring wealth. A lot of dumb people make millions and genius people barely pay their bills. There's millions of cases like this. It's not a set rule that the smarter you are, the more money you make. Not always. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. Some doctors cannot pay their bills. Some doctors cannot find a job for a year. Lots of computer genius people work from job to job. I met some of them over the years. With such knowledge, should have been multi-millionaires. And in reality, they barely have a job. Why? Because Hashem said so. And many other examples, that's not the topic right now. So now it's the time more than ever. I had a very interesting case last week, before Shabbat, before Yom Tov, of one person that used to donate every month. In the last 3 months, before the corona even started, his business wasn't doing so great. He said, don't deposit the check. Next month, don't deposit the check. Maybe next week, don't deposit. Don't deposit. Don't deposit. Don't deposit. All of a sudden, I hear from a relative that he got the corona and is in very bad condition. Cannot even say a word. Cannot breathe. Cannot say a word. Not a word out of his mouth. Cannot breathe. Connected to oxygen. And next step, God forbid, is the respirator. That they put him in coma and... Hashem irachem, if he comes out of it or not. I started to pray for that person. You know, after all, you have to pray for anyone you can, especially if you have gratitude to someone who supported you. Then all of a sudden he called after a day. He called himself. He could not say a sentence on the phone. He could not say. The conversation took two minutes. I begged him to hang up. But it took him 2 minutes to finish a sentence. What was the sentence? Breathing like this. Please, it took him half a minute to say. Deposit the check. Why? Any minute, chas v'shalom, I can leave the world. I remember from your lectures, what's going to save life? Only charity. Nothing else. Doctors, with all due respect, they're not God. 3 hours later, the brother of this person called me up. He said, Baruch Hashem, there's a miracle. I already had a conversation with him. So I cannot be. I say, cannot be. I am the with my low level of emuna. I said to him, you sure you spoke to him, a conversation? Because he could not say a word. He said to me, I don't know. He was able to speak. Still breathe heavily. But this is just an example of the power of tzedakah. Mamash, by a miracle, within a few hours, a person all of a sudden begins to breathe. Why? Because even when, God forbid, if there was a decree on that person, there could be that second that a person made a decision, I will still support, no matter what, that can change everything around. Mamash, it could be a minute before the execution, a minute before the angel of death is pulling out the soul. Hashem say, come back, not this time. And there are examples in the Tanakh. There was a decree, death decree against King Hizkiyahu. Hashem sent prophet Isaiah, to prepare him for his death. As the king of Israel, one of the greatest kings ever lived. Top three. So why should I die, he said. Because he never got married, he didn't want to get married, he didn't want to have children. So why? I don't want to get married because I know I'm going to have wicked kids. I see it in my holy vision. I'd rather suffer all my life without a woman. A person without a woman never reaches complete level. I suffer all my life just for this, and for that I deserve to die. The prophet told him, you're not God. You cannot do calculation based on future and prophecies. The Torah says, first commandment, you shall get married and have children. This is for men. Men has obligation to do everything they can to get married and have children. That's an obligation for men. Obviously, you cannot do it without a woman, so the woman becomes a part of the mitzvah. The obligation is for the man, purvu. He had to get married. What comes out of you? You do your best. The rest is not in your hand. There are things, you don't know what kind of soul Hashem is going to send you. Maybe he's a wicked kid, and there's a reason why Hashem sent it to you. He wants you to give him all the treatment that he needs, that later on he won't have any excuses. That Hashem reincarnated him in a bad family, and what kind of a chance he had to become righteous. Could be many reasons for it. Sometimes they'll be only wicked up to a certain point, and then something will turn around, and they'll be very, very big righteous. So what happened? There was already a death sentence. So what did he say to Hashem, to the prophet? Go to Hashem, tell him, I committed a sin. I'm going to fix my thing. There was a decree on him already. What happened? He cried, and the prophet cried for him, and in the end, Hashem gave him 15 more years to live, even when the decree was already signed. So there are cases like this, and the Gemara told us the secret. What is the number one tool in a time of pandemic, world war, tragedy, all kinds of problems? What is it? Charity is the best weapon. If you have lack of faith, or you're stingy, or whatever the case is, you may bring your own death on yourself. Why? Because, unfortunately, you read, you listen to lectures, and you don't understand. And you don't understand. So there are hundreds of cases over the years of people that mamash, nobody believed that they'll come back to life, and the charity saved their life. You know, but again, that's not the topic now. I just want to focus on this important thing that we all ask: how come righteous people are dying? How come big Talmidei Chachamim are dying, big scholars of Torah are dying, and not only very old ones? Yes, most of them were in their 80s, 90s even, late 70s. That's already ages that people usually die. What can you do? Nobody will stay forever. But even people in their 60s passed, and even in their 50s. And few even in their 40s. So the question is, what's going on here? Answer number one, not everyone that the world thinks is righteous is really righteous. True. The world always had people that from the outside look much more than what they really are. Okay, and the Gemara say, "Mefarsemim et hachanafim mipnei chilul Hashem." If you know the real status of these people, that people think that they're extremely righteous, and you know that they're wicked, it's mitzvah to publish them, not to fool the public. Why? Because when Hashem will punish these people, everybody will say, oh, why the righteous people get punished if they were righteous, but they were not. So that's one option. But we all know that some of these names that passed are not only righteous, they're very, very big righteous people. Some of them I know personally, here from town in Monsey. Big, big tzaddikim, much like the book. See that the Yirat Shamayim, the fear from God, the love of the Torah, the manners, the unbelievable people, big knowledge. Their whole life was in holiness. And they went away. So first we have a rule. Every person has a spiritual value in heaven. Reuven, Shimon, Yitzchak, Levi, Davi. Every person has a value that changed by the second. Go up, go down, depend on what you do. Learn Torah, it goes up. You stop learning Torah, it stops going up. Then if you're supposed to learn again and you don't learn, it begins to go down. You have to pray, you don't pray, it goes down. You pray, it goes up. You give a lot of tzedakah, it goes up. You steal, it goes down. You speak Lashon Hara, it goes down. You make all kinds of other sins. It keeps going up and down your level. Depend on how much repentance you do, how much charity you give, how much Torah you learn, how much you pray, how much you're working on your character and your personality and your manners. There's many, many criteria here to evaluate. So the value of a person is endless. It can go from zero to billions. It can be negative. Wicked people, a lot of them have negative value. They're very, very wicked. Machtia Rabim, they influence the public to go against God. They put doubts in people's mind against the Torah. They make all kinds of mixed parties and all kinds of non-kosher discos and bars and prostitution and who knows what. Drugs, drug dealers, mass murderers. Their value is in a big negative deficit. So now, why do I say that? Because in the Torah, physically, every person worth more or less the same. Actually, the way they evaluate people is depend on how much money they have or not. If somebody famous and rich, people pay more attention to the death of that person. If he's homeless in the park, how many people care about his death? Unfortunately, this is the way they are, by money. But when it comes to spirituality, money is not the way to measure a person. It's the mitzvot. Torah, holiness, integrity, honesty. What kind of a character this person? Modesty for a woman is critical. Shabbat, holidays, emunah, faith, prayers, pure heart, not pure heart. Okay. Once, sometimes you can see, you find a righteous person that equal like 20,000 other Jews. You put him on a scale on one side, you put 20,000 individuals on the other side, they're all not keeping Shabbat, they all make sins, they eat not kosher, they lie all day, they steal in the business, they do horrible things. You put them all together, you accumulate all the good they do. All the good together that they do does not come to what this person alone does. So what does Hashem do? Instead of taking 20,000 people, that's what the Satan demands. The Satan is the prosecutor. He's sitting in heaven in a court every day and make claims against people. It's not fair. How they still breathe. How much longer you're going to tolerate them. And at Rosh Hashanah, Hashem has to make decision. He's a fair judge. He can do whatever he wants. He makes a system of rules. Prosecutor has the right to make his claims. That's the way Hashem made the world. And there's nothing really to defend these 20,000 wicked people. So what do Hashem do? He make an exchange. Say, okay, look, this person is equal like all 20,000 of them, or 10,000, or 5,000, or 1,000, or even 100. Still a value. I will take him now instead of them as a sacrifice. And we'll give them a few more years to make tshuva, to make repentance. It's a shame for me to lose them for eternity. Because if they die now, they're mechalelei Shabbat, they have no share to the world to come. So I'll take this righteous person to heaven, I'll make it up to him, he's not going to regret it. But that will be instead of him. That's called a sacrifice, korban. We learn it, one of the sources, as I'm going to give some of them now, we learn it from what we read yesterday, Shabbat. Or even though we don't have the shuls open, for the people who organize minyan in the neighborhood outside, they know that they read probably yesterday, Parashat Shmini, in Leviticus, the third chapter in Leviticus, Parashat Shmini, speaking about the death of Nadav and Avihu, the sons of Aaron the Kohen. He had four sons. Two of them passed in a second. And they passed in such a way when they came actually to sacrifice what they were not asked to do on their own will. And two lines of fire, like laser, came from heaven into their nostrils and burned them all from inside without burning the body and the clothes. Very interesting. Usually when you hear about someone who got burned, he burns with his face, with his skin, with his body, with everything, with his clothes. How do we know that their clothes stayed complete? Because right the next verse, right after that, that they carried them out from their clothes. The clothes were complete. The clothes did not burn. You cannot get burned and your clothes stay complete. So from here we learn that the way Hashem burned them was not something from the outside. It's very shocking when you see a burned body for the people. From inside it looked like they fell and died. But they got burned from inside. This part of the death of the sons of Aaron will repeat in Parashat Acharei Mot. Parashat Acharei Mot is a substantial parasha. We read parts of it in Yom Kippur, the holiest day of the year, day of atonement and repentance. In the prayer of the morning of Yom Kippur, we read about the death of the sons of Aaron, Nadav and Avihu. In the afternoon, before the end of Yom Kippur, in Mincha, we read also a chapter from Parashat Acharei Mot, who speaks about all the forbidden relationship, forbidden intimacy. This is all in Yom Kippur. Why do we read about the death of the two righteous people, the sons of Aaron HaKohen? Right? The Torah say, Be Krovai HaKadesh. After Hashem took their life and Aaron was silent, he did not make a beep. Seeing such a tragedy, you lose two out of your four kids in a second. I don't have to tell you the feeling. He did not make a beep. And Moshe said to Aaron, Hashem told me that he's going to do a big sacrifice with the people that he loved the most, meaning his like relatives. I was sure it's me and you. Now I'm actually shocked to see that they were greater than us, that Hashem took them instead of me and you. This is the conversation of Moshe and Aaron, his brother. And the reason we read about it on Yom Kippur is because the Gemara is teaching us that the death of the righteous people is a sacrifice for the entire sake of the Jewish nation. The whole nation is actually benefiting from the death of these righteous people, because instead of them, they should have been the people. The fact that two people died like this, it saved probably thousands of others. And this is what the Gemara in Masechet Baba Kama said, En poranut matchila, ela min atzadikim tchila. When a tragedy is begin, it starts from the most righteous people first. In the chapter of Shmini, as I just mentioned, is described the death of Nadav and Avihu. The Ari HaKadosh, the holy Ari, 500 years ago, the biggest Mekubal Kabbalist in the last 2,000 years. Everything we know basically about reincarnation comes from his writing, of his student Rabbi Chaim Vital, that wrote everything. We know about reincarnation in raw material, in animals, in plants, in people, in all kinds of birth defect people and brain damaged people, everything with his own reasons. We all know from the Ari, it's called Shara Gilgulim, the gate of reincarnation. And the Ari is teaching us that actually Nadav, the son of Aaron, came back in reincarnation as Samson the prophet, who fell in love with a non-Jewish Goya, a Gentile Delilah, the Philistine. And she basically destroyed his life. In the end, she betrayed him. He told her the secret that his power comes from his hair because he's a Nazir. He is not cutting his hair like the Nazir. It's holy from birth. And she told the Philistines, and she drank him wine, and they cut his hair. And when he came up, he could not fight them like he used to kill them all the time when they came to attack him. And he realized, that's it. He's worthless now. He cannot do anything. They took him to jail. They connected him to this grinding stone instead of a donkey to push it all day. Well, they were making fun, getting drunk, making fun at him. Not only that, they hit a knife and poked his two eyes, made him blind. The Gemara say, why a righteous prophet from birth, that Hashem sent an angel to his parents, Manoach and Tzlalfonit, that was his mother, and told them that you're going to have in a year a boy, that you should start already not drinking wine and be holy from birth, because this is going to be a servant of God. It's from birth. It's before he even came out to the world. You should already understand that you don't have a regular baby here. Someone like that ended in the worst way, that they tortured him, poked his eyes, took him to the stadium, tied him to two poles with 3,000 people laughing and screaming, drunk in the stadium, Philistines, murderers. And what happened in the end? He asked Hashem, give me my strength for the last minute and let my soul die with these wicked Philistines. And Hashem gave him one more time the power he had before. He knocked down the two poles. The whole stadium came down. All 3,000 of them died with him. And the Gemara stayed in debate if he has a share to the world to come or not. That's how bad it ended. Why did he get such a punishment? The Gemara said, he put his eyes in a woman he could not marry. She was forbidden to him. You go to get something Hashem told you you cannot have. It's against the rules, against the law. She's not a convert. She's not in the process of converting, but soon she's going to be Jewish, that you want to marry her. She is what? She is a wicked woman that obviously even betrayed him and got him to die and to suffer. So who is this Samson, the Ari says? It's written, Vayi, Shimshon, Badan. Dan is the tribe of Dan. Badan, it's the same letters like Nadav, the son of Aaron. Why the son of Aaron has to come back in reincarnation? He was holy when he died. He had one more sin to fix. One more sin. What was the sin? The Gemara brings a list of the sins supposedly the sons of Aaron did. In the Torah, you only know one reason. They sacrifice fire when they were not supposed to. Okay? But the Gemara brings a list of other things they did. One of the things they did is they said, when is these two old leaders, Moshe and Aaron, they're talking about their father and their uncle, when will they pass that our turn will come to be the leaders? Righteous people usually don't speak like that, especially on their own father and their own uncle. It's hard to believe, but the Gemara, if the Gemara brought it, that means Chazal telling you that with Ruach HaKodesh and Kabbalah from generation. You obviously cannot suspect the most righteous, holy rabbis in the history of the world that will make up a story against holy people and ruin their reputation out of nowhere. Obviously, we wouldn't do such thing. We wouldn't speak against Moshe Rabbeinu, against holy people from the Torah. Definitely not those Tanaim in the Gemara. So obviously, they bring it with sources. The next thing they say, that they also did not want to get married. Every woman they were offered, they turned her down. They're not good enough, she's not good enough. I don't know what was the reason. Not smart enough, family, not pretty enough. Whatever the case was, they refused to get married and they actually died single. And therefore, Hashem sent, at least Nadav we know from the Ari, that sends him back in reincarnation. And what was his punishment? That now he will ended up falling in the hand of this cruel Goya, will torture him and bring to his death. You do not want to marry a kosher Jewish girl? You look at this Goya, that's where you ended with. And the Gemara say, the eyes that look at something forbidden were poked. This is what I've been screaming for years, and some people get upset for no reason out of ignorance, that the Torah told us the rules. And rule number one is everything Hashem does has a reason. Rule number two, everything he does is measure for measure. There's no random punishments. Through the punishment, you can get the hint why I'm doing it. What bothers me? What is the scream here? Same thing now. Synagogues are closed. Check what possible sins and problems taking place in synagogues. Check all the list. It could be any one of the above or all of them combined. Check why yeshivot are closed. What are all the possible problems in yeshivot? Politics, hatred, sinat chinam, racism, throwing kids out. Look at the whole list. Check. After you review the whole list, it could be either one of them or all of them combined. We don't know. We're not prophets. But we know the rules. And the rules help a lot. And if you don't investigate, you're an infidel. If you just say, it's not my problem. I'm not God. We have no problems. Nobody knows. Don't pretend you know. People that speak like this, they spread heresy. It's against the rules. The Rambam say if a person says it's nature, he's a cruel person. Cruel. It's cruelty. It's only going to add to the punishment. When Hashem is screaming, children, wake up. And people say, nature, put mask, clean your hands. You have to clean your hands. You have to put mask. We have to make an effort to live. But that's the main thing everywhere you go. Just about this. What about uncovering your real face? What about making tshuva, repentance? What about having clean hands, not from coronavirus, from stealing, from the blood of your brothers, from the deceiving, from other sins you make with your hands? What about that? That's all of a sudden became secondary. It's not so important. So we have to understand why Hashem is targeting all the righteous people and a lot of the rabbis and the leaders of the community. What can be the reason? Let's look at the entire list. One is the death of the righteous people is a korban, it's a sacrifice. It's written in the Song of Songs, Dodi, meaning God, came down to his garden to pick up the roses. The roses are the tzaddikim. It's also written by the prophet Isaiah 57:1. A tzaddik avad, the righteous person passed, then ishama lev, no one pays attention. Not only nobody screams and cry and ask forgiveness from the tzaddik that he died for us and from Hashem that we came to such a situation, nothing. Ve'en ishama lev. This was written 2,600 years ago by the prophet Yeshayah, Isaiah. En ishama lev. Nobody cared. Almost nobody cared. Ve'anshe chesed ne'esafim. The kind people, the most kind people, are collected. They are dying. Be'en mevin. Nobody understands why. Because of all the evil and bad things that we did, the tzaddik was collected, was taken away from us, the righteous person. It's written clearly that when the generation commit a lot of sins, who pays the price the most? The most righteous people, the leaders of the communities and the yeshivot. It's written in Masechet Shabbat, page 33, Bizman Shatzadikim Metzuim Bador. When the righteous people exist in a generation, the righteous people are held responsible. They died or they are being tortured for the sins of the generation. Be'avon Ador. Why? If there is no righteous people, let's just finish this sentence. Who is held responsible? The babies, the children that learn in yeshivot, Talmudei Torah of the kids. Even they are clean from sins, they are going as a sacrifice. They will go to heaven. They won't lose. The tragedies that will be shaken up when we see seven children die like a few years ago. The Sassoon family, Aleihem HaShalom, this holy sacrifice, seven kids who got burned on the holiest day of the week, Shabbat. For us that will be able to continue to breathe and maybe we'll do tshuva. Did we get the message? For a week, for a month? What happened after 3-4 months? Anybody remember that, unfortunately? Some people do. The mother, the relatives, the neighbors, people that are seeing, they're dealing with a tragedy. Seven holy kids. Holy, for sure, from Talmudei Torah. Each one probably saved thousands. Who knows? It could have been 50 or 100,000 other people, if not them. It's written here in Gemara Masechet Shabbat. Why the rabbis of the community are being punished first? What's the, why are they held responsible? Rabbi is not God, he can't change the world, he can try, but why is held responsible? The Zohar say that they should have protest and rebuke the wicked people. And not only they did not rebuke them, they respected them and caused them to be weak in the service of the religion. In Zohar, in Shmot Yud, Shmot Exodus 10, it says two reasons why righteous people dying from the world before their time came. One is because there are many sins in a generation and more wicked people multiply, and the righteous people that live among them are held responsible for their sins, and that's why they died. And once they died, Hashem gave extension to these wicked people. Well, why I have to pay for you? Why he has to pay for him? Because he had the power and the knowledge to speak and to shake up the people of his community, people that read his books, people that listen to his lectures. And instead of rebuking and threatening them and waking them up and describing to them what's going to be their end if they won't change their evil way, like we saw hundreds of times in the Tanakh, not only they did not do it, many of these righteous leaders, they kissed up to the wicked people. You're great. We appreciate you. Maybe it's the time to read briefly. It's a very long letter that someone sent today all over the social media in Israel. It's unbelievable. I'm not going to read the whole thing, just some parts of it. If you want, I can email you. If you understand Hebrew, I can email it to you later on. It's a letter that was printed by a rabbi in English originally. It was translated to Hebrew. Maybe you can find the English one. His name is Nachman Kahana. I don't know from what community, from what city, somewhere in America. He published his name. He wanted his name to be published, so that's why it's no problem to publish the name in an original letter. And listen to this letter. In recent weeks, our life has changed dramatically. Our routine got messed up. We're all confused and scared. We're insecure. We don't know what's going to happen from today to tomorrow like it never happened in our life. This time was a time of thinking, of calculating our way, recalculating our way for all of us. I came to a painful conclusion, which I would like to share with you. I misled you. I did not do it on purpose. I did not even do it with conscience. But deep inside, a part of me always knew that I'm misleading my community. And today, I must get clean up. Allow me to explain. I developed love to the Torah while I was learning in yeshiva when I was young. I wanted to continue to learn in the same level for the rest of my life. For me, to be a rabbi was the only way to fulfill my plan, my dream. Our community is full of professional business people that helps the community in many different ways. They also have love for the Torah. They learn in classes. They leave some time every day to come to Shiurei Torah. In every open opportunity, they're looking for the right direction when questions arise. They try to run their house based on the way of the Torah ideology. I have a lot of appreciation to these people, but I should have done more. I should have been surrounded with Torah all the time. You know, I learned in a hard way. I made myself a resume. I did everything I can to make connection with the right people in the right places. I got all kind of job that allow me to step in with my feet into the door of big institution. Eventually, I got opportunity to a full-time job in a synagogue, which was small at that time. I stayed there for 2 years to develop and work on my skills and to make myself a reputation. When a better opportunity came, I jumped on her. One thing led to another until I became an important rabbi of a community, of our wonderful community. And job that I enjoy more than 50 years of fulfilling. He was like eternal in this kind of job, to be a rabbi of a community for 15 years. Now I know that my way to this career as a rabbi was different than any other professional person. It's different than the doctor, than a lawyer or a businessman, which I always felt in my heart that they are less than me spiritually. In every step of the way, I try to climb the ladder and to reach the highest record possible, just to keep my position. I always look who can maintain and pump my career. I kiss up to them with no shame. I always recognize the leaders, the powerful people in the synagogue, in the community. I always make sure to keep good relationship with them, to kiss up to them when it's necessary. Even when I saw that they behave in an inappropriate way and I looked the other way, I always found excuses to justify me looking the other way. This was the only way to stay a rabbi and a leader of a community. It was the only way to influence the community in the long run. That's how I convinced myself. Otherwise, I would be fired and look for another job, and someone else would do anyway what I'm doing. So why shouldn't it be me? It's better I'll be here than someone new. I can't blame myself for compromising and making all this hard decision that today I blame myself. And it's actually stopped to be difficult. I lost my way. It was more important for me to be a rabbi and a leader than to actually have responsibility as a spiritual leader and a real teacher of Torah. I lost my ideology of my childhood, the mission I should have followed. I became just another professional with a degree and an office. The recent weeks helped me to understand what I always knew deep inside. I never rebuked you. I did not speak in a tough way with you because I was afraid about my job. I convinced people not to move to Israel, young people that wanted to move, because I was afraid that our community would have less people. I convinced the elder people not to move to Israel because they were the sponsors and did not want to lose their money. I convinced people to do things that was the opposite of what's good for them. I lied to myself. I misled you, my community. But I cannot longer live with this lie. I'm very sorry from the bottom of my heart and ask for your forgiveness. It's maybe easier for me to understand that now when Hashem closed our synagogue and the yeshivot and all the organizations are closed and we don't know when they're ever going to be open again. The financial burden and situation can cause that many of them will not survive in a best case scenario, you know, and the dream of climbing the ladder to a greater career and to become a rabbi, it's not as relevant as it was before. The only place that is virtual as it was is my repentance. It may not be complete, but I must make repentance. I encourage all of you, those who ask me to move to Israel, they should have moved to Israel. Enough with the excuses, enough with the personal calculation and what's good for me and what's good for me. All kinds of wrong calculation. We know deep inside that many of us, Hashem wants us to move to Israel. It's starting with me and my family, and everyone wants to join us. I'm willing to sacrifice my prestige position and my great salary and to just be a simple citizen in Israel, if that's what it takes. And I took my old blown ego down to serve the Jewish nation, to go back home, to bring with me my family that's already preparing for Aliyah. And I encourage everyone to follow me to Jerusalem. And this is a letter of a person that finally, after 15 years, finally came clean and said what I've been screaming for 25 years. And people ask me, why you don't speak in this shul? Why you don't speak in this shul? Why that shul doesn't let you speak? I always told them, because there's always someone over there that is afraid that the wicked people will get angry when someone will tell them that it's not proper to come to shul on Shabbat, or it's not the right way to be gay, or it's not legal to marry other people from different nations that are not Jewish because the Torah forbid it, or to speak about the modesty of the women, or to speak about being honest in a business, and many other problems that all of us have, with no exception to the rule almost. And one friend of mine once called me to his synagogue and told me, I want you to come here and speak a very strong lecture about modesty. That was more than 10 years ago. I asked him why. Whatever I know, you know and more. Big chacham. He said to me, I tell you why. Because I know my people here. They're very modern. They're very university ideology people. If I will give them a lecture about modesty, how they come to synagogue and disgrace the place, most likely by tomorrow I'll get fired. Who is going to come in front of, instead of me? They're going to get some kind of very modern Orthodox that barely keeps mitzvot, or conservative, or who knows what. That will be the end of them. If anything is happening now, it's thanks to the fact I'm here. But to live with what they do and the way they dress and how they behave on the synagogue, I can't. I know I'm going to pay the price. So why don't you come, speak very strong. I know they're going to get angry. They're going to come to me and complain, why did I bring you? And then I'm going to allow me, I'm going to say, listen, I didn't know he's going to speak so strong. At least let them hear the truth. Here is a hero. Smart. He knows it's a catch 22. Oilim Omar, Oilim Lomar, like Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai say in the Zohar. The last generation before Mashiach, oh, if I will say, oh, if I will not say. I don't want to live in that generation. Why is he such a test in Emunah? This was our days. Spoke about it 2,000 years ago. But we have to know one thing. So the rabbi, that rabbi, he said, look, I'm here, I'm doing a lot of good things, I make some people become better, but I don't have the power to change the level of modesty of the women here. Let somebody comes in that tells them all the truth, and now if 5 women will change, 5, 10, 20, out of 50 or 100, better than nothing, obviously. If no one will change, at least when I stand after my ears in front of Hashem, he will ask me, why your community, instead of coming to the synagogue, they thought they're coming to the beach. I will say, I brought a rabbi that spoke the truth. What else could I have done? But that's one out of who knows how many. Everywhere else, same story. People in the board, not Shomrei Shabbat, not married to Jews, making millions in corruptions, all these things. They control our communities. You know what? Hashem say, enough is enough. Don't want to look at your faces. Just close all the synagogues. I don't want some of the synagogues were built with blood money, with drugs money, with Avodah Zarah money, with corruption of Wall Street, with stealing money from customers, with bringing all kinds of things from countries that they torture children over there to prepare these products. What do we know? If Hashem does something, it's for nothing? It's definitely for a reason. So before we finish, let's just conclude this. And one last thing. There's one more reason why Hashem sometimes takes righteous people in the times of pandemic or war or whatever the case is. What is it? You won't believe it. Because Hashem sees that these righteous people beginning a process of going down in their spiritual level. They reach a certain age, 60, 70, 65, 75, some kind of an age. All their life they were superb. Now something just happened. Maybe they had a crisis, made them a little bit weak. Maybe they got fired from their job. Maybe they don't teach Torah anymore. As long as they taught Torah, it kept them always connected. Now they lost the geshmak, the desire to teach Torah. Because of that, they're beginning to go down in their level, in their own learning, in the way they used to be. So Hashem said, you know what? Let me use you as a sacrifice and save the life of 10,000 for the time being. Before you also lose your Olam Haba, God forbid. That's another reason. We should all know, Rabotai, Hashem put us here for a reason. It's not a picnic. The world is not a picnic. Life is not a picnic. Some people think it is. They would be very upset when the time comes and they see the truth. But one thing we should know, that when Hashem put Adam over here, this is what he told him. וייקח השם אלוקים את האדם ויניחהו בגן עדן. He put Adam in Garden of Eden. לעובדה ולשומרה. Supervise, work here, reserve the garden. And the time Hashem created Adam, he took him and showed him all the trees in the Garden of Eden. And he told him, look how wonderful and superb is my creation. And all of that I created for you. Make sure you won't dare to destroy my creation. Because if you would, no one after you will be able to fix what you destroyed. There is a danger here. But the question is, who is the danger to? To the creation, to the world, or to the individual? The answer, both. You're destroying Hashem's world, and there will be consequences to that, to the next generation. We deal with some of the horrible things that the past generation did in the world. We live with that today. But the main concern and risk is what's going to happen to you when you dare to go and challenge Hashem's creation. You want to make gay marriage. You want to make mixed parties. You want to create all kinds of things. Like now they say there's a network of 5G who is responsible for this corona. I don't know how much of it is true or not, but thousands of people claiming it, and a lot of them seems to know what they're talking about. Who knows, maybe all these 160,000 victims is because of something that they do behind the scene. Maybe vaccines, like some people claim, are causing the death of so many people in the world. Obviously, someone invented these things. Even nuclear. Nuclear bomb that killed millions of Japanese. Someone invented it. We all know who. So the point is, Rabotai, is that the Torah told us that a person is being judged and being paid for good or for bad based on the fruits of his action. Meshalem la'adam kipri ma'alalav. Not based on his actions, based on the fruit of his actions. What's going to come out of it? And that's why we have to be extremely careful, especially now in his judgment days in our life. It's written in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 50, verse 20. This is what's written. Bayamim ahem, at that time, he's talking about the end of days after the Messiah will come and there will be the war of Gog Magog, and either before or after the time of the resurrection of the dead, after Hashem cleaned the world from all the wicked people, Jews and non-Jews. It's written in Zechariah 14. You can review it over there in the Tanakh. This is what's written, Rabotai. Bayamim ahem, ובעת ההיא נאום השם. And that day, meaning our days, this was written 2,500 years ago. This is the speech of God. If you request to search for the sin of the Jewish nation, you won't find it, it's gone. And the sins of the tribe of Judah, which is among us, some of us came from Israel, some of us from the tribe of Judah, you won't find it. Because I will forgive those who I will let remain. Not everyone will remain, Rabotai. I've been screaming it for many years. It's written. What's written, it's written. That's a prophecy. It's the word of the creator of the world, not mine. It's written clearly. And Gaalti etchem acharit kereshit. I will save you in the end like I saved you in the beginning in Egypt. 20% only got saved. 80% died. 12 million died in the darkness. 3 million came out. 12 million did not go out because they refused to go out of Egypt. They wanted to be religious, but to stay in their houses, to go back to their houses. Nobody will bother us anymore. Everybody saw, you cannot mess with our God. Look what he did to them. Let us go back to our property, claim it back. Hashem said, no. I am the God that took you out of Egypt to be a God for you. Ani Hashem Elokechem. Asher hoceti etchem me'eretz Mitzrayim liot lachem le'elokim. To be your God. No other reason. Not to make you an athlete or a basketball player or a businessman or a model or I don't know what. This is all by the way. If you want to find a way to make a living, if it's kosher, fine. That's not the purpose of your life. I feed you one way or the other, with that, without that, with degree, with university, without university. Just don't make sins. I'm responsible to take care of you. But that's what we forgot. אני השם אלוקיכם אשר הוצאתי אתכם מארץ מצרים להיות לכם לאלוקים. That's the purpose of the Exodus of Egypt. And the prophets say, and גאלתי אתכם אחרית כראשית. אחרית means in the end. כראשית like in the beginning. The last geula will also be 20%. And what it's written in the prophet, we say it every day when we pray in the morning, Kedusha. What does it say? ובא לציון גואל לשווה פשע ביעקב. And the Savior come to Zion, the nation of Israel. For whom? For those who returned back from their sins, made repentance. Leshave pesha be'akov. And that's what it's written, Rabotai, She'erit Israel, the leftover of Israel, after the big cleanup, will not make sins, will not have stolen goods in their hands and stolen money and deceiving money. They will not charge interest, they will not do deceiving, and the righteous Gentiles that will survive will also be clean Gentiles, lovers of God, lovers of the Jewish nation, not thieves, not murderers, not idol worshippers, not Christians who believe in all kinds of nonsense, a man that they decided to make him a god, and the rest of the fake religions, not this kind of Gentiles, the real one, the good one, that some of them support, sends donations to my organization, save our Jewish brothers and sisters, many of them. I don't know if without their help, the organization can even survive. Sometimes they care more about our own brothers and sisters from our brothers and sisters. I'm ashamed to say it, but the truth is the truth. It's a big shame for us. Your brother is drowning and stranger has to come from far and save him. Who has the obligation, you or him? The neighbor has to save your brother or you have to jump into the water? If you don't have the ability, you beg the neighbor, fine. Well, most of us have the ability. We just never got the point and now it's more than ever critical to give tzedakah, as I explained before. The Rambam, Maimonides, the biggest rabbi in the last 1,000 years in Halacha, by far, no question about it. Almost 90% of Shulchan Aruch is based on his rulings. He was a big doctor, philosopher, astronom, mathematician. His statue is in Washington even. The Goyim admired him. The hospital in Brooklyn, Maimonides. Everyone who's intellectual knows Maimonides, the Rambam. Lived 850 years ago. Spain, then in Egypt. And what does he write? Listen to this, Rabotai. In the Laws of Repentance, chapter 7, provision 7. The tshuva, the repentance, bring back the people that are far from God. Atshuva mekarevet et arechokim. That's why we call it Kiruv. That's why the name of my organization is Rabbi Mizrahi Kiruv Organization. What does it mean, Kiruv? To bring someone that is far closer. Closer to who? To the creator of the world and his Torah. Closer to life of eternity full of reward, as the Torah promised. And not, God forbid, life of destruction and a horrible destruction after he leaves the world and has to pay for his crimes. That's what Kiruv is about. Yesterday, he was hated in front of God, despicable, pushed away, an abomination. Find me worse words than this. This is the answer to all the fakers, some of the speakers that go out and have the nerve to open their mouth and speak the lies that they spread against the Torah and tell the wicked people, don't worry, God love all of you. There's no such thing, wicked Jews. It's enough, you Jew, you go to heaven. The rest of their lies and nonsense, kissing up to people, thinking they're doing them a favor and they bury them for eternity. Wait until you see the punishment of those speakers that they will get in the afterlife. For murdering so many innocent souls, people are naive, they don't know. See a person with a beard. My Rebbe promised that you go to heaven, you have nothing to worry about. Ah, or the other clown that said, there's no hell. Really, there's no hell. Oh, he is the new God. He made a new Torah. I don't know. In his Torah, maybe parts of the Torah was deleted. Modifying the Torah. And they, by the way, make fun at Reform people, but they are much worse than the Reform people. Because every normal Jew knows a Reform person is a clown. Every person knows it. If a person tells you, I'm a Reform rabbi, what do you expect? It could be a goy, non-Jew, rabbi. Go to Manhattan, see who the Reform rabbis are. Korean, this, Chinese. People that have nothing to do with Judaism. They made themselves rabbi. They went to university, learned Judaism. The Reform takes everyone, no problem. Or a gay, living with a boyfriend, married to his husband. He can be a rabbi, a criminal like this. This is a joke. Most people understand that this is a joke. But when it comes to this supposedly Orthodox or modern Orthodox that spread their lies and bury the people for eternity, people don't understand. They have a wishful thinking that this speaker knows what he's talking about. They don't want a strong speaker that speaks to wake up the people and tell them, wake up before you finished. Nobody likes to hear from his doctor that his situation is critical. Everybody would prefer a doctor that they take two Advil and you're good. I don't need anything, don't worry, it's nothing. Well, what are you going to do when you die? You're going to sue the doctor? We're in the court of Manhattan in Two Federal Plaza? By Judge Williams or Jackson or Judge Cohen? Where are you gonna sue the speakers who you fooled by them to follow their nonsense and their lies? That they tell you it's okay if you mechalel Shabbat, it's not the end of the world. What do you mean? The Torah says it's worse than a murderer. That's the truth. It's written in the Rambam also, and in Shulchan Aruch. How much more lies you're going to spread to the people? And then you wonder why we are in a situation like we're in. So let's listen finally and observe the words of the greatest, the Rambam. Not me, I'm nothing. Don't say a word about me, I say, I didn't say. It's nothing to do with me. I just tell you with sources. You don't believe, go and check. Rambam, Laws of Repentance, Chapter 7, Halacha 7. Halacha number 7. Check it for yourself. Read it in the English version or any other language. The repentance brings the people who are closer from Hashem. Yesterday it was hated in front of Hashem. Despicable. Pushed away. An abomination. It leaves no doubt, right? What God think about the Mechalelei Shabbat and the idol worshiper and all the other abomination parades and all that. And people who eat taref and non-kosher and lie and cheat and do all these things. And today, after he made repentance, this is the laws of repentance, he is loved and nice and close and a friend of Hashem. A week ago, despicable, hated, pushed away, abomination. Today, Hashem opened his arms. Come, my son. Here is my house open again for you. You're not pushed away. You're not despicable. I can finally look at you. Why? Because you say, Hashem, forgive me. I realize my mistake. Help me out. Send me the right rabbis, the right speaker, the right CDs, the right USB, the right books. Let me learn the right Jewish ideology, the 13 principle, the correct one, not the fakers, what they spread. Be very careful. I have a list. 14 fake speakers. Two of them are chief rabbis of England. The most dangerous speakers out there today. You have to be very careful who you listen to. You don't care about their titles from the Queen Elizabeth or from the Queen Margaret. Who cares? What does she know from her life? She knows what Judaism is about. What do we care about what university they learned their Judaism from? We care about this kind of clowns that promote homosexuality and claim that Adam and Eve is a parable, never existed. Today someone brought to my attention another one of their jewels, the former chief. What did he say? That no religion is perfect. Every religion has some truth in it. Such an infidel. No wonder. It's the same one who said there was no Adam and Eve and there was no Exodus of Egypt. And every time the Torah contradicts science, you have to go by science. Basically, the Torah only gave a parable. Such an infidel. Chief rabbi of a country. No wonder no serious Talmid Chacham in England look to their direction, to these clowns, because they know the difference between a real diamond and a cubic zirconia. The problem is that a lot of naive people do not know who we're dealing with yet. That's where the problem is. And they're going to be the victims of these people. So anyone who still did not get the list from 1,000, more than 1,000 people got it. More. But it's not enough, only 1,000. There are tens of thousands of listeners. What about the others? They don't want to be careful who they listen to? They would listen to someone that it's a sin to listen to? Or not to talk about, to support them in any way? And the Rambam concludes that the tshuva, the repentance, brings the sinners closer to Hashem, whether it's an individual, whether it's a group of people. Rabotai, what can be more clear than that? Hashem said to us, you don't really call me. You're really not worshipping me, you're not following me. Ve'ata ayef ve'yageah. What's the difference between ayef and yageah? Ayef, it's tired. I didn't sleep at night. I'm falling asleep. My body is tired. My back cannot get up. I cannot run. I cannot pick up anything now. I'm half asleep. That's called tired. Fatigue of the body. What does it mean, yageah? Like we say, lo nigal arik velo neled la be'ala. Yageah means spiritual exhaustion. I'm exhausted mentally. No desire to wake up to go to prayer. For nonsense, wake up like a tiger. They have to go to synagogue. All kinds of excuses in his mind. To learn Torah, you have to beg him, you have to bribe the kid. Come, learn an hour, I'll give you something you want. Yageah, fed up. That's called yageah, spirituality. And this is what the Hashem say. Ve'ata ayef ve'yageah. Ki lo oti karata Yaakov, you're not calling me the nation of Jacob. Ki yagata b'Israel, you are fed up with me. That's why you replace me with the clowns. You replace me on your stupid vacations to Cancun. You replace me from your materialism or by all kinds of sport activity. You replace me in any possible way. And then you say that you're religious, who are you fooling? You don't have any desire not to learn Torah and not to keep mitzvot. Sometimes you do it because you're afraid of the punishment. Better than nothing. Better than not to keep at all. Saves you from a lot of horrible consequences. But if you already do it, don't you want to do it right? What will wake up your soul? Only lectures like this. You can lie to yourself, you can run away from it. You can run to all kinds of fakers to tell you, to tap you on your head and your shoulder, you're great, don't listen, it's fanatic, it's extreme. You can lie to yourself. You'll pay the price. You'll deal with this stupidity. You're going to run away, you try to circumvent the problem. No problem. I'm not coming after you with a gun. I did my share. The rest is in your hand. No one will do the job for you. It's written in Pirkei Avot. Imen anili mili. If I'm not going to take care of my soul, who's going to take care of my soul? Who? Im lo achshav emata. If not now, when? Tomorrow it could be one day too late already. It's written, Hashem tzadik ifchan. Hashem is judging the righteous. Ve'ish chamas san'a nafsho. And a corrupted person he hates very much. Hashem hates very much the wicked people. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. It doesn't matter what's your last name and who's your grandfather. You are wicked, Hashem cannot stand you. That's the truth. As painful as it is. But it can change in a minute. All you have to do is say, I'm sorry Hashem, I went too far. Chatati aviti pasha. Forgive me. Help me. I want to come back. Already, your status changed. If the Messiah come a minute later, he's going to look at you. You didn't keep one Shabbat. You didn't give $1 tzedakah yet. You did not open one page of Gemara yet. The fact that you made a real honest decision, I'm going to change. No more Chilul Shabbat. No more sex crimes. No more stealing. No more cheating customers. Let me do it the right way. It may take you 10 years to get there. Sometimes even 30 years. But you got on a train to the right direction. Like Rabbeinu Yonah said, mityatzvim al darkei atshuva. it stepped on finally the right highway to the right direction, which is repentance. As it's written in the Torah, "Veshavta ad Hashem Elokecha, veshamata bekolo." You return all the way to your God, to the right direction. And you listen to him, and Hashem will have mercy on you. It's also written that David HaMelech said to Hashem, and we have to learn from it. It's in Psalms. It's a part of our Tanakh. What does it say? It says like this, Shim'a Hashem Tzedek, listen Hashem, righteousness. Akshiv Arinati, listen to the way I sing for you and praise you. Lelo Siftei Mirma. Why should you listen to me? Because I have beautiful red hair and beautiful eyes. No. Because my father is a very big rabbi, Yishai, the biggest in the world. No. Why? Because I take care of the sheep, because I fought the lion, because I fought Goliath, because I'm a hero. No. Just listen to me for one reason. This is a school for each one of us. This is a school, Rabotai, for life. Listen to me when I praise you, when I sing to you, when I play my violin for you, whatever. Because my mouth is holy. It's not a liar and a deceiver and a faker. When I go and meet the kings as the king of Israel, what do I speak about? Sport? Theaters? Stadiums? Highways, trade, animals, stock market, war, security. I can care less about this. When I gather with the king, it's written in Tehillim, Pasuk in Tehillim. Hashem put it in the Tanakh, means he approved it. All I speak about is you. I come to all these goyim, the king of Persia, the king of this, the king of that. When my turn comes, like today in the United Nations, the King David of Israel, please rise and speak. What do I speak about? God and his greatness and the temple and the Torah. And believe it or not, it means that the king actually let him speak. I remember when I started my first steps in Judaism, many years ago, I was still a banker working for a bank. I had to go to Milwaukee to a convention, weekend convention. I told them, listen, I have limitation. I cannot eat with you. I have to have my room in a hotel, in the same hotel where you're doing it, because I'm not going to come there. No problem. Whatever you want, we'll take care of everything. They order for me from Chicago, glad kosher food and stereophone wrap. Everybody eats over there. And me, with a little sandwich with cold cuts. All the goyim could not believe what's going on. First of all, I was the youngest one. I was in my 20s. They all were 40, 50, 60. People with history and sense. This Israeli guy is eating strange. We're vegetarian? And I said, no, don't you see? It's a chicken. Oh, yeah, you're right. So what is this? Well, why are you eating like this? Your special diet? I said, no, I'm religious. I started to give them a speech. He had to see after an hour all these black, Chinese, Korean, Americans, Italians. They forgot about the convention. Started to speak, this black guy asking me, tell me about the sacrifices, what's behind that? Why would God want this, that? All of a sudden, I give them a speech, as much as I knew. The goyim are more interested to hear Torah sometimes than us. They came to learn about tricks, about the banks, about the market, competition between banks. I stole the show, not because of me. They saw me with a yarmulke eating strange meal. All the goyim wanted to hear Torah. That was the conversation of this whole weekend. So if it happened by me, imagine by David HaMelech that knew all the Torah in the middle of his sleep. Slept only half an hour in 24 hours in his life. 7 years of holiness. And what does he say? Listen to my prayers, not because of anything, just one thing. That you know I'm not a liar, I don't lie. I never say heresy from my mouth. I'm not saying nibul peh. God forbid to even think such a thing. But en li mirma, no deceiving in my mouth. Tochi kevari. And Hashem said, true. It's in Tehillim. If it wouldn't be true, Hashem would come and say to him, excuse me, enough with your illusions. I will finish with a sentence from the book of Rabbi Nachman Mibreslev, Chaye Moharan, speaking about doing tshuva, repentance. Shamati, that's after he passed. The book that was written in his lifetime was Likute Moharan, that's the most reliable one. Other books that came after all, only Hashem knows who wrote them, how, what situation they wrote them in, but this is in a book that is famous by Breslev. It's written over here, something that Rabbi Nachman said while he was still alive. And this is what he says. Shamati she'amar, yesh li asaga kazot la'Hashem yitbarach. I have some kind of achievement, enlightenment, to God Almighty. That I could actually bring the Messiah by it. But I pushed everything away. Listen carefully. He pushed bringing the Mashiach, the Messiah, away. What can be more important than this? Apparently there is something that it's even more important than this. What is it? Ve'lakachti atzmi etzlachem, and I came to be your rabbi, speaking to his students, in Uman, in Ukraine, to bring you to be righteous students, lamutav. Ki ze gadol min hakol, nothing is greater than bringing Jews closer to Hashem, to be decent Jews, religious Jews. And then he rebuked all his people, Anshe Shlomo, meod, very much. And he say, how much I suffer and worked hard for all of you. How many times my throat were dry and hurt, no saliva left by me, from speaking and begging all of you privately and publicly to speak to you in any way to make you do repentance, tshuva, to bring you, to do kiruv with you. This is what's more important even than to bring the Mashiach, Rabotai. You hear this, Rabotai? I could have brought, if he could bring the Mashiach or not, only Hashem knows. But the concept of that there is something that it's even more urgent than this. What? To save another Jew and another soul. How many times I tell people, use your millions to buy billions of mitzvot. Once you die, that's it. No more buying mitzvot. Now you can buy it for thousands of dollars, 1,000, 5,000 every month you send. You don't even feel it in your cash flow. Especially all the people with the big pharmacies. This crisis made them more rich. Big doctors. Use the wealth you just get. Some people made lots of money in the stock market. Where are you people? Why don't you care about your brothers and sisters that are dying out there? They need financial help. They need spiritual help. They need to listen to Torah to cheer them up. Torah saves the depression. The people from Chas V'Shalom ending up committing suicide. Where are you people? That's the question Hashem will ask each one of you. And I will finish with a word of a very big Chacham. Not Jewish. Not from the Zohar, not from the Gemara, not from the Chumash, not in Shulchan Aruch, not in Hebrew. An American very big Goyish scholar. You'll tell me after who said it. If you know, if you don't have something that worth dying for, you don't also have something that it's worth living for. Who said this smart sentence? The Torah says, Chochma b'goyim ta'amin. When a Gentile says something smart, adrabah, you're allowed to use it. Why not? The truth is above politics, even if he's an anti-Semite. He says something that is true. It's true or not? This one apparently is a big truth, not just truth. He actually said, if you live your life and you don't have a goal, something that it's worth living for, something that it's worth dying for, and meaning when there that particular one, you're willing to die for it. Could be your family, could be your wife, could be your children, can be your parents, can be your Torah, can be your title, can be your job. Everyone with whatever he believes in. If you don't have something in your life that it's so important to you, that it's worth dying for it, it's either I have it or I rather die, that means you don't also have any reason to live. And this is perfect, perfect to what Hashem tells us, the Jewish people in the Torah. He speaks for his own people. This was Martin Luther King. Spoke to Americans, mostly to black people, but also to white people. There is a day after him in a calendar, Martin Luther King. But in the Torah, it's way before him, that Hashem told us, Ki ma Hashem Elokecha shoel mi'imach. What am I asking from you? To build the whole world? What am I asking? To torture yourself? That's against Judaism, to torture yourself. To fast every day? No. One day a year, it's enough. What am I asking from you? Just to have fear, Yirat Shamayim. To respect who you're dealing with. Not to be ungrateful. To appreciate the greatness I gave you. Not to use it against me. What am I asking from you? It's not across the ocean. It's not above heaven. Ki karov elecha davar beficha ubilvavcha lasoto. It's so close to you, in your mouth, in your hands, in your heart. Three things. Three. Beficha, words that come from the mouth. Torah, learning Torah, praying, praising Hashem, Tehillim. That's called Beficha. Ubilvavcha, in your hearts, all the mitzvot of emunah, faith and confidence in Hashem, honesty, integrity, wisdom, that's in your heart. Mercy, all these things come from the heart. Beficha ubilvavcha la'asoto, la'asoto, to do with the hands. Tefillin, lulav, sukkah, whatever you have to do, right? Tefillin, mezuzot, slaughtering the animals before you're allowed to eat them, so they don't suffer. That's the three departments. Beficha, mitzvot that are coming from the mouth. I have a whole list, which mitzvot connects to what category. In the heart, it's include also the mind and the hands. And if we will do that, Rabotai, I promise each one of you that we won't need another tragedy, we won't need another pandemic, we won't need another war. Even Gog Magog doesn't have to happen. Every bad prophecy doesn't have to happen necessarily a minute before it can stop. If we make enough Jews become Shomrei Shabbat and connected to Torah, it can turn around. It does not have to be the hard way. It can still be the easy way if we will be able to make a lot of people become Shomrei Shabbat. All of a sudden, the majority of the Jewish people are following Hashem. You understand? So, Rabotai, this is it. We concluded basically this weekly lecture. Maybe I'll have the throat to be able to do another lecture. We did one earlier today in Hebrew. It's already basically 4 hours I speak straight, or more, no? Benji, what is it, 4 hours? What is it? Yeah, we started at 3 and now it's 7. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen v'amen.